158th birth anniversary of Sigmund Freud, and he still seems to draw a crowd.
And but it's also a birth of two other organizations. I will introduce one, and my perennial co-chair, Honey, will introduce the other. The first organization, or rather network, that I want to introduce is the one called Psychoanalysis India. This is the logo which our artist had made. She was supposed to be here, but due to a personal tragedy, she's not able to be here at the moment. I hope she comes at the end of, by the time the talk ends. So we had run an award for the designing the logo, and everybody in psychoanalysis is an art critic. So despite all the, this one is the only one which made it past all the critics. So this is, as you see, the Matsya avatar of Vishnu. And it has a story behind it. The story is the regular story, of course, the mythological story. And then there is another story which involves the speaker of our talk today, and his talk a very long time ago in Ahmedabad regarding mermaids, which I shall divulge after the talk, maybe. So if you want to keep in touch with what's happening with this organization, Psychoanalysis India, there are various ways in which you can be in touch with it. This organization is essentially to facilitate psychoanalytic psychotherapy, both the therapy, the teaching, and the training of it, with the use of whatever technological means that are at our disposal, and trying to integrate it with technology and medicine. So this is the website which has just come up, and as you see, Sudhir Kakkar is there on almost all the pages of our website. I don't know how he feels about it. We'll ask him soon. So this is actually the Facebook page which we just launched a few weeks ago, and due to the support of most of you here, it's been quite popular, and it's quite a fun place to be if you want to read up about all kinds of stuff about psychoanalysis. And this is the YouTube page where we upload the latest videos, including this one, as soon as we get them. So every Friday we have tried to accumulate all the previous recordings of psychoanalytical gurus from Sudhir Kakkar to Dr. Nagpal to Salman Akhtar and so on. So every Friday we release a psychoanalytical gurus video, and during the week we keep on releasing videos related to psychoanalysis, most of it original. Not all of it original, and we connect you with other video links to psychoanalysis. Yeah. This is, of course, the Twitter page. If you really want to up-to-the-minute updates, you join us on Twitter and you get stuff as and when it appears on the Facebook side, etc. So I think I'll leave you at that. This is the Google Plus page, and I'll invite Honey to tell you a little bit about the Center for Psychotherapy and Clinical Research, which is the other baby which is being born, and then we'll get the two men on the stage. Thank you, Honey.
A lot of you are already familiar with the Center for Psychotherapy and Clinical Research, because a whole lot of you I see are already from AUD or people who have been associated with us at Delhi University with the Center for Psychoanalytic Studies. Well, formally, the Center for Psychotherapy and Clinical Research came into existence in July 2013, but we have been working on it for at least a decade before that. So in some sense, it has its parentage in the Center for Psychoanalytic Studies at Delhi University. This is a center which has multiple goals. It has the goal of providing quality and in-depth psychological services, not only to those who can afford, but even to those who cannot afford but are in need of help. That is one of its primary mottos. It is also a center which aspires to be a strong research base on understanding a culturally sensitive nuanced understanding of the human psyche. So we would be carrying on researches on the human mind, psyche, culture in its interface. It is also a center that we hope that over time would become a place where continuing education for mental health professionals, be they psychiatrists, psychiatric nurses, clinical psychologists, psychodynamic psychotherapists, etc. So the center would be a platform where debating, thinking, deliberating, and taking the movement of psychoanalysis forward in the Indian context. And we also hope that we will have some impact on policy and advocacy in the mental health scenario. So that's as far as the center is concerned. And if you visit the AUD website, you will get some of the goals and ideas on which the center has been founded. I just want to say one thing from the side of the center, while Professor Ashok Nagpal, who's at the heart of the center, would be delivering the talk today. And I'm sure that he will take us through very, very deep corridors into the human psyche. I just want to make a comment on the context. I think birthdays are always about beginnings and about history. And psychoanalysis has also had not one history, but it has had more than one history. And however, there are forgotten histories of psychoanalysis. And one of the forgotten history of psychoanalysis has been its history of being a socialist discipline. We don't think about it today. We don't talk about it today. But I think till his much later years, till almost the time that he was about 60, and a speaker is also of the same age today, Freud was a social democrat. And he always believed that psychoanalysis was not a discipline only for the elite. It was a discipline which needed to reach the margins as well. So that's something that I hope we will remember as we take psychoanalysis forward. And I think the issue is not just about, you know, doing low-cost work for people who cannot pay. In times like ours, where we are at a difficult historical juncture, I think it is also about what money does to the human mind, and also about when we do not charge very high, what kind of human subjectivity do we foster? So these are questions along with the talk that I think we need to bear in our mind. Thank you.
Okay. So as you see, this talk has three logos over it. Starting from the left is Ambedkar University, and to the right is Fortis Hospital and Psychoanalysis India, somewhere in the middle, trying to be integrating the left and the right, the money and the ideology, and to keep things going, as Vishnu the Preserver would like us to, I suspect. So in that spirit, I would like to invite Professor Anoop Dhar. This is the first time I'm addressing him as Professor Anoop Dhar. He's the chair of our session today. He's a very dear friend. Anoop is currently Associate Professor at the School of Human Studies, Ambedkar University. He is completing a book manuscript titled Psychoanalysis and Sexuation in Cultural Crucible, Genealogies of Aboriginalization. And he has co-authored a monograph titled Lesbian Standpoint. He is the director of an ICSSR project titled The Experience of Gendered Violence, Developing Psychobiographies. He is a member of the editorial board of the Annual Review of Critical Psychology. Please give him a big hand. He is here despite a lot of difficulties in various spheres, and I'm glad that you made it. So I leave it up to you to introduce Dr. Nagpal and to take it forward. Thank you, Anoop.
Thank you, Anurag. Welcome to this discussion, and let me first call upon Professor Nagpal. Please join us. How do I introduce him? It's a difficult task. I actually met him first time in Calcutta. We were trying to, and that time we were in Bangalore, and we were trying to bring together psychoanalysts all over the country, 2008-2009, and see if we can have some discussion, develop something. So this was a time when I was at CSCS Bangalore, and there we were all trying to come together. And the first conference we organized was in Calcutta, Department of Philosophy, actually. Jadavpur University hosted this conference. And the conference was on transference. And the Bombay analysts and some other friends, the Calcutta analysts, all came together. And I remember I was told by Ashish Rajadhaksh, you may try to see, there is one Dr. Nagpal in Delhi. And I thought, yes, okay, a psychiatrist, Dr. Nagpal, interested, maybe. So let me see what I can do with him. So my networking self thought, let me get in touch with him. And I got in touch with him. He got immediately interested, this Dr. Nagpal, and said, okay, I'll come to the Calcutta conference and let us do something on transference. This was cusp, actually. That's how it was beginning at that time. And he then said, my colleague, Dr. Honey Oberoi, will also come. I said, okay, fine, let both of them come. So this Dr. Nagpal, who I thought till that time was a psychiatrist, and Dr. Honey Oberoi is a psychologist. So that connection I had made. So one psychiatrist and one psychologist, they are coming to this Calcutta conference. And then he came, he arrived, and we thought, okay, since he's coming all the way and he's showing so much interest in transference, let us have a session also with him. So we allotted a slot also for him on transference, and we thought it would be appropriate to put Dr. Honey Oberoi as the chairperson in that. I don't know what's driving Anurag to do this. And he came, he delivered his talk. Quite an amazing talk he delivered in Calcutta. My problem was, I did not fully understand what he said. And the usual Indian route is rejection. What I don't understand need not be understood. We always transfer it onto the speaker and say, he must be saying something very, very difficult, unknown, troublesome. What I don't understand is not so important, perhaps. I approached it a little differently, luckily. I thought I have to understand him. And over the years, have become slowly his student. I started as a colleague, have increasingly become a student of Professor Nagpal. I also address him as sir, though he has never taught me formally, and have spent a few years trying to understand him. And I think it will be upon the audience today also to either reject him or understand him. I could have given other kind of formal introductions of Professor Nagpal. I thought this is the challenge before Psychoanalysis India: rejection or understanding. One last point. Psychoanalysis India is a clever move by all of us. Me, Honey, Anurag, many others in the room. I can't take all the names, I think. To defer a very, very critical question. Is it psychoanalysis in India? Or is it Indian psychoanalysis? And because we cannot clinch it straight away, which way, we call it Psychoanalysis India. And we keep this question a little deferred. Hope today's talk between rejection and understanding will offer us some perspective on this very difficult hyphen between Psychoanalysis India.
I think when the challenge is formulated like this, Am I audible? No. Let me feel you. I think my voice will rise then. At the moment, the topic, a whole lot of the occasion, its impact on me is a little acute. I can't fully connect with my own thought. I'll go slow. I'll take my time so that I don't get rejected easily. But my effort is to connect with two difficult themes that came into the title as if by a delicate engineering of few minds. I was going through my own difficulties with my eyes and was least willing to take on this kind of responsibility against a stream of my own wishes and desires to do it one day, to connect with the audience outside a classroom, whose interest in psychoanalysis from various vantage points could be gathered. And suddenly this call in the morning by Anurag, that he has thought of two things together in one breath, Freud and me. And while he thought of it, it was a very auspicious moment because a beautiful woman passed by. So this talk was conceived with two men and a beautiful woman passing by. I should also add here that given the state of affairs of my right eye, I'm certified to carry distortion. So each time a distortion happens, make a note of it so that you can later on raise a question or an issue out of it. The theme, if it had been my choice, would have been relational yogi rather than relational guru. But given Anurag's penchant for looking at gurus, I didn't object much. Instead, I set myself to understand the relationship between a yogi and a guru. And I thought, in hindsight, one can say that the choice of guru is a more useful one in order to evolve the notion of relationship as Freud inaugurated. Guru, as we know, is positioned a little bit in darkness. And miraculously, finds light, creates light, throws light, and a consciousness arises. I think Guru is often lost. In having done this for us, he's often lost. He's often lost to the conscious cognition, and perhaps as a compensation, we endow him with almost divine powers. The inevitable choice that gets made between rejection and understanding. Freud, in our collective approach to his thought, seems to have retained this prospect for us, that this guru and the lineage of gurus must try to understand the impact of darkness in terms other than that of understanding. So they would reach understanding, but the means to reach those understanding were to be found in a way other than the cognitive modes. So relation is drawing upon the theme of something that allows us to project our darkness onto it, to to show a mediation, to show an exchange, is where the term relation emerges. Would Freud himself have liked to be addressed as guru? Is a question that I think is going to gnaw at us. How are we going to change a presentation of Freud if we take him, if we posit him as a guru of the kind that doesn't go too far away from the inclinations in us to look at guru? So when we take up guru, I would also request us to keep thinking of a yogi who is abstaining all the while, so that the relationship with darkness is forged through abstinence. It's all at the moment perhaps in the air a little bit. For us, the important thing to bring Freud is to bring the several beings in us that we have often made a good relationship with, whether this is the child in us, whether this is the adolescent in us, whether this is the adult in us, whether this is the other sex in us. I think with varying degree of difficulties, we find that we have kept them together across dissociations, through passages, and sometimes speak in voices more than one self. If I may call each of them as selves, then you would say that there are several selves with each one of us. And in a very crude way, the term relationship, with the addition of the term ship, could be a reference to something docked or swirling or receiving the currents of an oceanic magnitude. So a relational guru is an attempt here to present Freud in terms of an inauguration that he did in the history of relationships as well as ideas about how to receive each other. Honey brought up the question right in the beginning of moving from margins to center, or remembering the margins while we have come to the center. Anoop, in his own ways, is also indicating that we are perhaps bypassing few difficulties. I think to the extent that we are sitting here, we are also suggesting that an exchange of minds is crucial for an eventual relationship with the theme of guru, with the theme of a relational guru. That somewhere there's an inclination to capture a link. There's an inclination to say that so long as the mind is induced to relate with something different, there is a possibility that we could proceed. And I think one of the concerns that Freud had was whether we relate to the experience of the other, and especially the experience which is going through a symptomatic breakdown. Being a psychiatrist, his first concern was how to heal, how to cure the sickness. Is it too close? Bahut distance le? Itna ya relationship ki baat ho rahi hai. फिर पास आ गया था या आई गो स्लो बिकॉज़ आई फील दैट सम ऑफ दीज आइडियाज विल रिक्वायर दैट इन द साइलेंस दैट हैपेंस हियर सम ऑफ यू कैन ब्रिंग अप थिंग्स एंड ऑल्सो इट गिव्स मी अ चांस टू बी अ लिटिल एक्सेंट्रिक बिकॉज इन माई साइलेंस सम ऑफ यू कैन रीड दैट आई एम नॉट बीइंग एबल टू गैदर अ थॉट एज वेल so that you will do your work. Also, I'm used to talking to people in small groups so that I managed to catch a sense of what they're going through. So this is an unusual setting for me. In a very categoric tone, Freud wouldn't have liked himself to be called as a guru. His work is largely a work based on negation, based on trying to see what does not give me, as a listener, a clear sense of what is happening with the other. His specific movement in listening to his patients was where he doesn't understand, where he cannot figure out what is happening, and whether he can use a thought from various other cultural streams to connect with what cannot be understood. So a guru who has not figured out in himself the experience of a potential disciple who is at the moment plunged in varying degrees of darkness would be the first image that we need to have in terms of situating this relationship that Freud established with his patients. And this establishment was not an easy one. It took years for him to reach that sense of, even as in various strokes of brilliance, he could slowly see that he is many. He is himself a child. He is himself a Jew. He is himself an adolescent. He has himself had many memories. But where is he a woman is something that we'll take up much, much later in today's talk. How did I come to this? I think this might help us to organize the processes a little bit now. In this first installment of my exchange, I'm suggesting that there is something difficult ahead of us, in which if I become too clear, then I think Freud becomes the guru. Whereas if I stumble a little bit, you can see that I'm trying to represent Freud's struggle authentically. Not that I know how to be clear in the initial phase. I really don't know how to be clear in the initial phase. So there's a punctuation here. In a session, perhaps things may happen something like this. I came to this relationship with Freud in which I found myself coming upon coinage of a title for him as a relational yogi when I read an essay by him titled as Beyond the Pleasure Principle. I don't know how many of you have read this essay. As an aside, I should say it doesn't matter whether you've read him or not. That's one special advantage, and that's why perhaps the term guru, that we expect the guru to take you where you are, begin from where you are. But reading him, of course, adds to movements and pace in a manner that is unprecedented, dreamlike, and produces a thought which is not easy to gather in writing. While reading that essay, I found he was drawing upon various sources. This is one of the essays which is like a watershed, because he almost touches a language which is not replicated before this, in which he revises his theories, his theory of psychic structure, his theory of dreaming. Both these theories are crucially revised after this work. And here's a man who is surrounded by world wars, who is surrounded by losses, being the head of a joint family, a large joint family, losses, close losses in the family. And here is a man who is given to thinking about experiences in metapsychological terms, which would mean for us amongst other things, which would mean that we would like to know that if a loss has happened, what does it make it emotionally difficult for me to recall in myself? What does it stun in me? One could say, what does it threaten to kill in me if a loss has happened, especially if a loss of a significant figure in through death has happened? So what does it aim at killing off in me, suturing off in me, stilling in me, stunning in me, and so on? So better psychology will begin something like this, that where is this loss registered? And as this loss is registering itself, what are the ends where I cannot figure out so that my thinking is stunned? And as my thinking is stunned, anxieties and emotions emerge. And as anxieties and emotions emerge, who do I turn to with newer patterns of demanding and dependence, of demand and dependence? And in these newer patterns, can I voice things that as an adult I may have forgotten how to voice? So that there's a double frustration here. One of an encountering of a new self, which one has not, new is not a good word for it, but I'm saying new self so that you'll be a little curious about it. And second, not knowing how to express it so that you're left at the means of something which is the definition of ego. That you can't see it, but people close to you who are empathically connected with you can see it. So the unconscious part of the ego is the people with whom you have significant relationships. Since you don't know how they work, how their mind goes, how their consciousness goes, we would say they are ego. It's a thought that is worth thinking about, that not just intrapsychically, but also in terms of significant relationships, people who think on behalf of you, so that it allows you to be nervously evolving an experience which has not, beyond the description that a loss has happened. I'm sure we are all aware of the fact that losses have a way of slipping away from us and then revisiting us in ways that we don't know how to atone for, how we let it slip, and how to gather it, knowing that we will be able to one day bring them closer to it. Somebody should indicate to me when the loss and the trauma language becomes too much, by shifting noisily in the seat. Because amongst the vignettes, I have also searched for where joy produces a split and unconscious. So that also I would like to share with you. But while trying to understand this term beyond the pleasure principle, each term is what Freud writes about, I came upon a paragraph which talks about the history of mankind, which is like earth and sun. Nag super. Yeah, I think I'm gradually settling down in my sense of you and you in my sense. So I think the echo is not, this anxiety would change. Huh? The paragraph is about the relationship of earth and sun, and how this might be imprinting itself. He doesn't say might be. He's categoric here. How it imprints itself on the human race, on the organic life, and how instincts as a part of organic life, as conservative parts of organic life, might be retaining those imprints, and through repetition might be suggesting a relationship with the consciousness, so that the history is preserved, so that the unconscious as an immortal is preserved, not only for a particular culture or society, but universally. But what is surprising is this straying into a cosmic relationship of earth and sun. Poetic relationship, somebody might say. He doesn't let you imagine him as a poet. Huh? He had musical blindness, huge musical blindness. So that possibly cuts out the task for a society like ours, which is Bollywood all the time blaring into our minds. At one point I thought I'll run some film songs here to enable a bit of a resonance of ideas as they would be slightly chipped at, unknown to us, so that we can have a sense of how in living we don't always concentrate like this. But this would not have been a good tribute to Freud's birthday. I think we should respect him, how he began, so that we can see at times when we reach there. But when I cite this, I'm suggesting that that was a complex writing. And this particular paragraph was very complex, and I had no idea how to connect with it. I don't think I struggled with it too much. I only found it repeated in my writing. I cited it in that essay that I wrote about this paragraph, as if inviting a group of readers to carry it from there. But even as I couldn't develop it further, I also found myself going to three myths in Hindu thought where a character meets death. Because Beyond the Pleasure Principle is the first essay which Freud, where Freud introduces his speculation about death instinct, without naming it as death instinct. He's only highlighting that there is a force which is supremer than living and makes its own presence felt in living while all the time pulling it towards Nirvana principle, which is to bring all organic life to inorganic state. As I said, I couldn't understand this. Psychoanalysts over the decades, maybe more than a century now, close to a century. This was written in 23. So there is a scathing revision of this thought, except for the French school of thought and French school of psychoanalysis, which has managed to give it a certain place and managed to define the work of death instinct in terms of unbinding, that in terms of how we forget to connect with the familiar, how we forget to connect with what we wrote in a state of a mood ourselves, how we just do not know. So what changes about a statement that we have written ourselves, so that its impact on a particular day is like an insight, and on subsequent days we have no idea what it is trying to aim at, throw light on, and so on. I took a long leap, avoidant leap from here in that essay. But the leap carried the imprint of death. So I thought, if I can get vocalization, dialogues between three characters and death, the god of death, since our culture is well known, our civilization is well known for its preoccupation and evolving of death close to birth and death as it marks living. So I thought if I could go into parables of these characters, this would help us provide a rejoinder to Freud's thinking. That was my innocent hope at that time. I went into the fable of Nachiketa. I went into Yudhishthira's walking into whatever heaven, hell that he walked into. And I came closer to Savitri's dialogues with the god of death. I'll cite only one of these three, especially, in fact, I was telling Anup that so many men in this hall, is something like a surprise for me, because we are often meeting women in our classes. And so to that extent, we have a much greater acceptance of bisexuality in ourselves. I hope many men, as they will hear a bit of few excerpts of this Savitri Yama dialogues, will pardon me and we'll connect with the way Savitri evokes something for us. As all of us, I hope, know that Savitri manages to wrest a verdict where her husband Satyavan is supposed to die on a particular date. And she is one person who meets the god of death and through a dialogue with the god of death manages to, if I may say, seduce him into awarding a rebirth of Satyavan as Satyavan. I still recall, this was 4 years back, reading those descriptions, I couldn't believe that a seduction was happening, because as a child, when we had heard that fable, that we would think there is a way of hoodwinking the god. We have no idea that the hoodwinking can be evolved into seduction. But the impact of hoodwinking was a much stronger impact on me. So I couldn't see the seduction very clearly. But slowly as I read and reread that, I had a sense of what Savitri and the god of death were doing. Four boons come her way. She is a woman. She is a child born after much prayer by her father. And the father has wished for a boy. The boy doesn't come about. Savitri comes about, a very beautiful woman. Her beauty, in fact, acting as an obstacle in her life, because no man can look her into her eye. You know. So in pre-modern times, if those times can be called pre-modern, Anu, she is given a special license by her father to create an entourage and look for her husband, which is not that of Swayambhar, which is still under the auspices of your own palace, and you can, Sita can look at Rama and so on, but this is like she goes from one kingdom to another kingdom, and finally comes upon Satyavan, the son of a dethroned king. And for 1 year, and she comes back, and while she comes back, Narada is sitting with her father, and upon knowing whom she has chosen, Narada immediately tells her about the fate of the general kundali of Satyavan, that he's going to die exactly a year after. But she says, I've already decided to marry him, and that is it. So this one full year, she lives in a forest along with her in-laws and the husband, and each day carries this imagination of the husband being lost, husband dying after a year. So each day is what Freud later on talks about, a mourning already happening. Each day there is a sense of that something is going to come to an end is already happening. How does this change the character of Savitri is where we are. On the day when she is with Satyavan, she's already observed a 3 days long penance, an acute rigorous one, so that she can connect with something internal. And in the forest, when Satyavan suddenly expresses an excruciating pain that he can't stand and he collapses, that's where Yamraj appears. The conversation between the two are clinching. Something about our civilization is indicated in those conversations. It refers to death, God of death, as a force of equity, as a force of discipline, as a necessary force of evolving saintliness, and as a force which has a family. Who has a family? So before the boon, the last boon comes of 100 sons, she reminds him that how he is the son of this God, who is sun god, and how in so addressing him, his responses are that I've never heard this part about myself, that no mortal has addressed me like this. Excited and thrilled by this encounter, the God finally gives the boon of 100 sons. This is where the child's consciousness, I had interrupted this story as a child. I thought, enough, mil gaya, we want 100 children, she's got it. It's like a song that I often try to remember for the audience that I always forget, but there's a song in which, a duet which is going on, in which she says, tumko mujhse pyar hai, na 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 na, and suddenly, ha comes about. So it's, I thought as a child, this is what she managed to do to Yama, to delude him into a sweet talk, so that he would say 100 sons, and then he has to send the husband back. But no, when you read the details of these dialogues, you find that there is an aplomb at this point. She knows she's got the boon of 100 sons from her husband, but there is a composure, there is no hurry. In fact, there is a further address of who he has meant for her, you know, and how being with him a while extra is indicative of an attempt on the part of the future living to connect with the force of death. That is a crucial part of this myth. Not to fear death, because one has already lived its loss in one's imagination and practice, but in fact to be able to reach the secret of what the death enhances in us. It sharpens a particular bond, even as it produces a perspective of when this bond will enlarge, transcend into something unlike 100 sons. The last boon is that these 100 sons will be named after you as Savitra. These 100 sons will be called as Savitra. In a culture, in a civilization, in a society where we are struggling with security of women, this myth, for all its mythicality, is a reminder of a loss which need not only be weighed in terms of money and socialist thought or a capitalist thought losing itself, but in terms of, I think, developing this part of the meaning of death as this myth preserves, which is of a chosen unbinding and an acquaintance with new emotions, and finding that your own emotion of love in a particular relationship can outlast that. A slightly romantic one, but nonetheless, the arrival of composure in this is a remarkable arrival that I thought this myth preserves for us. My second vignette is the vignette of Freudian thought in institutions. Because we have often seen that in clinic, one can use this thought in a dyadic setting, experiencing and co-experiencing various emotions. But we find it difficult, particularly in India, because psychoanalysis in India has been there since 1910, okay? And it hasn't acquired a coherent body or set of practices or set of writings. It has always, like Savitri, begun to lament that an inroad by the Western translation of psychoanalysis, like God of Death, will come and usurp something. I'm inclined to think that we have not given it a good thought in terms of an abstinence here, an abstinence of what can be killed, what is worth being killed. Okay? Too often, I think we become gurus, too early we become gurus, while holding theories of self, but finding it difficult to connect with moments when our mentees and pupils begin to assert their self as a crucial test of the limit of our knowledge, the limit of our being, as all disciples, when they begin to get common in the surround of personal emotions, will do. They will create a parent out of us. So I recall how these things coexist while producing a lament on the one hand. I recall something that I witnessed in our own school of human studies, where recently there was a concern about, a collective concern in all of us about how a special program of mentorship that we thought we will introduce ever since we introduced our own programs, and how that will be consolidated, that a good thought needs to be given extending up to middle classes, that the image of ourselves being poor, each one of us being poor, is not given due justice. I believe that each one of us is poor in some ways, and we are quick to slip into that zone, okay, without knowing how to mourn the poverty, how to mourn the losses. And that's where perhaps Freudian thoughts might help us. So that I remember that in that particular meeting, on the one hand, there was a spontaneous participation by a student who, I hope she is here.
No, it is not.
And if she's not here, then we have a better way of valuing her. I remember her speaking, her first statement was, this was a participative group. Most of you were not present, so I have to share a few details. A participative group of students, faculty, senior management team, and many of us in the frame of the senior management team. So there's a fourth presence also. The frame of the senior management team, which is specially conscious, anxiously conscious, that we might actually miss out and we might come upon something that is going to point out glaringly our failure, and then we wouldn't know who to look at. Honey has only one small face. You can't all of you look at her. So this one student, when enough participation happened from of a more vocal kind, said, now I can't resist this. This was the first statement. Huh? Now I can't resist this. Now, right in this very moment, you can see a tension which says that even as I'm trying to absorb others, I have a sense I might be left behind. Or else that I want to come up, I'm not too sure whether I can join others. Or, as she developed that narrative further, that I'm not too sure in joining them I'll be able to overcome my own distaste about this difference. So that at one point we found her in a bit of a nervous jumble of words, saying that I felt in these 2 years evolving with my classmates, I felt as though I was a child and others were sheep, bhedcha. So people who she was aiming at emulating also were in one section appearing, in one perception appearing, as people who merely follow the rules and become like a herd, the herd mentality. Okay? And the narration was moving between margins, a central occupation, nervousness about the margins, and I think the audience was also beginning to feel that kind of a nervousness to say, how would this whole thing come to a denouement? How would the whole thing get concluded? And believe me, I was expecting that at some point when the conclusion will happen, the applause will be faster than conclusion. It'll be so anxious. And that's what precisely happened. An applause which was anxious, but also celebratory. When she concluded, this applause was that, yes, you have demonstrated to us what we have as a model in AUD tried to follow. We wanted our students to demonstrate, illustrate, to move from the margins to center in this completely self-unconscious way so that you can say, you are a human form, others are a herd. While the applause is also indicative that we respect and hold your anxiety. You don't mean it. You don't mean to declare others this, but in your bid to be there and uncertainty to be there, you somehow manage to imagine only this. I hope I'm making sense, this applause part, and I'm saying that, but right after that, as a collective, we all deliberated on the program and mentorship collapsing, not being able to rise to the occasion as we had ordained it, designed it, evolved it, aspired it. For me, this is the second vignette, a vignette by which a full anticipation of the product that we will create through our investment and energy, say in the mentorship program, how would this come to a form that we can anticipate and celebrate consciously? We are not in a good position as human minds, as collectives, to always find that our anticipations come true. We're not always in a good position. And this, I feel, should be thought of in terms of the relation that we establish with one-to-one people, because this girl had obviously benefited from her mentorship, as I learned later, and then see how people create new forms which are not imagined by the theoretical schemas or our energetic schemas in which we want people to become something. I wouldn't say what is often said, that is, become something in our images. As I said, that a guru has to be slightly in the andhakar, in the darkness, so that this risk of somebody becoming like you is minimized. This is my second vignette that I've shared with you. A third vignette is to go to a much wider space and a more contemporaneous space of the criminalization of politics. An issue that is invading us. I think we've all known our utter paralysis. And a violent paralysis. When I say violent paralysis, I'm assuming that for a short stint, a hope was aroused. Most of the educated sector in universities like AUD connects with the left-wing thought, also has a certain curious attitude about AAP. AAP, incidentally, is also the only way of invoking guru. The psychoanalytic guru, of course, can be named. You can say Sudhir as my analyst, or Neil as my second analyst. But the guru is often addressed as AAP. And there are long tags about how gurus' names are to be evolved as a part of a tradition. I wish to take you now to the life of a politician as portrayed in a program called Satyamev Jayate, with the title of Criminalization of Politics. And I want to show some links and some emotions that are brought in such a program. Perhaps some of you are aware about this program, that this program was conceived by Amir Khan and his team, in which on several issues of psychological importance, childhood sexual abuse, women's security, etc., etc. And this one was, I've seen few of them, not all of them, but going by this, the form of this particular program, I think I'm inclined to recommend that this program needs to be looked at, particularly by the psychological minded element in us. You know. So in this episode, we have a beginning in which Amir Khan invites an IIM professor, like a researcher, he's a researcher, to indicate to us, to spell out, not indicate, to spell out the degree of criminalization which has happened in our politics. And this is dealt with by the numbers of people, politicians with criminal records in Lok Sabha, as well as Rajya Sabha, as well as Vidhan Sabhas, state assemblies. And the percentage on average goes up to more than 30%, with grave charges of murders, rape, abductions, and what you can think in the category of grave charges. So the ludicrousness of how people appointed as leaders and being given security while until they were elected, they were being chased by the police, is pointed out by this statistic. This is followed by a couple. A couple in their late 40s. The husband speaks about the loss of his daughter, 20-year-old daughter, who was possibly learning some course in interior designing. And so she's sent from a small town to a big town, and she's sent to be with her Nana, with her maternal grandfather. The name of the maternal grandfather is Bhaiya Raja, or some such politician who has a well-known politician, notoriously known politician, but as a psychoanalyst, I think the well-known is not too far off as a mandate, that we also need to look at whether this badness, this grotesqueness can still be floundered about in terms of something that went wrong somewhere, without condoning it, or without condoning it in a way that we can't think about both the ends, you know. The short and the long of this story is that Bhaiya Raja rapes his own granddaughter, and on being threatened by her that she's going to divulge, he manages to get her killed. And the father of this daughter is there with his wife, and he shares with the audience about he was the first person who did not wear from testifying in the court, as a result of which this fellow was booked and sent for life imprisonment. And there were 82 cases of this kind on which he had been acquitted by courts because there was no one to appear and testify against him. In a brief, the sister of this couple, that is the bua of that girl, the aunt of this girl, comes up. Amir Khan, as a compere, asks her, "Do you have to say something?" And she says, "I can understand. I can understand that no one will come in this kind of a circumstance to support us, to give evidence. But at least give us moral support." I think I was left confused at this point. How can one give moral support without giving the testimony in the court? What would be the imagination of a moral support to someone in this kind of a circumstance? And I would extend it to you, this crisis, that what is the moral support that you can give? What is the moral support that we can give, which would be experienced as moral support if it does not become a testifying, a testimony in the court by which this person is brought to book? I had no idea. But I wanted us to be in this mood, that we have no idea as this program is evolving, for us to appreciate the next level. In psychoanalytic settings, the element of surprise is a special boon that the Savitri in the analyst gets. That Savitri in the analyst gets this boon because we can remain closer to losses, and we try to understand from that position, from that vantage point of loss, what is the good that might be beginning to get configured even as we take charge of the loss in a less hostile way. Not easy, but it happens. It happens because a certain relationship with one's own patienthood has also been evolved through a long training, through a long stint on the couch while you become an analyst, in which you freely speak whatever comes to your mind, from abuses to amusing anecdotes to fragmented memories to abracadabra. And the analyst, as a function, allows it. So while I'm trying to figure out what is the moral support in this, some people are shifting in the chair, there's no noise yet, huh? So that means I can still go on. How much time do I have? Okay, thank you. I think I won't take more than 15 minutes, if that's not too much. There's only one more minute. I think so far, the sense that I'm trying to aim at is a certain emotional set that we should experience to see how a certain thought can come out of it and links can be established here. The next episode in the same episode is of a politician who has been assassinated, Ajit Sarkar from Purnia. Some of you would know because he was assassinated in 1998, I think, after having won 4 consecutive elections. A CPIM politician whose son appears in this episode. The son is asked by Amir Khan to recount, since he is the son of this father, to recount anything special that comes to his mind about how was his experience of his father. How was this father? Before the son comes, of course, there are these small vignettes coming from different people who are saying he was a messiah, he was a godlike figure. You cannot find another figure like him. He gave us the home. He brought us from distant, remote places, utter orphanage, to this place, and so on and so forth. So you can get to see the kind of life this man was, and he was living amidst them. And they describe, I think, how there's no property that he has, and he used to pay a monthly rent of 600 rupees, and so on. So Ajit, the son, is asked, and he says, I can recount one episode, that when I was 17, 18, and how I'm a cricketer, so I played in a cricket match and perhaps produced an award-winning performance. Ordinary life. I forgot to add that even in that Savitri Satyavan thing, the story connects with the ordinary life. Once the boon has been given and he's been restored, the concerns of Satyavan and Savitri are not to go in for a rendezvous, which Savitri incidentally invites him for. But he says, no, my family, our family will be troubled. We must go back. There's an ordinariness, you know, that analytic processes also keep a special space for. So this boy, Ajit, says that on this day when I produced a match-winning performance and an award was to be given, and incidentally the function was to be, I mean, the award distribution was supposed to be done by my father, but at the award-giving moment, he did not turn up. In the evening, when I was there, there was also the SP of the area who had come to my place. So the SP of the area asked my father that we were all waiting for you, Ajit, why did you not turn up there? And he said that if I had turned up for giving a award to my own son, then people would have thought that I'm promoting him. So I didn't turn up. To which the son, there's enough talk about absent fathers in our culture, fathers who don't connect well, who don't, and also a distance that we create so that we are not seen as heightening this grandiosity in our sons and also opening ourselves to the charge that we are doing this. This against a hugely rampant ethos at the moment where we are talking about corruption in politics and dynasty. So he didn't turn up. The son, being an adolescent, says, okay, if you did not promote me in the next election, I would also not promote you. The son is quite sure that he has managed to put the father in the dock. But the father has a repartee, a smiling repartee that, son, I have more than 1,000 sons in this district. So if you don't promote me, they'll promote me. and the smile goes to the sun. One wonders what has read many clinical case histories of an intense sense of narcissistic injury at this point in the sun. That not only that you couldn't complain, it was SP who was saying that you were not present there, you know. But even as he managed to complain and managed to reach a position of ascendancy to say, there'll be my turn, this guy is put in his place, but with a smile. That's his recall. He's recalling that my father smilingly said, there is every chance that the moment may have been witnessed closer to, live closer to the son's emotion, and I wish it was. As an analyst, I would say, I wish it was, that he had some chance of living out the bitterness. One is not expected to be always understanding of these vagaries of one's father's supermodel stances. You know. A few years later, when he has won, he also describes another thing, that how my father would campaign. His campaign would be buying red-colored gamchas, red-colored thin muslin towels, you know, and they would be placed on the chalks of the various parts of that constituency, where people were requested that anyone who wants to give, anyone who's going to cast his vote for him, will just put a 1 rupee coin. Just a 1 rupee coin. Because for him, that 1 rupee coin was a way of counting how many people support him. And he, the son recalls that on the actual days of campaigning, my father would simply sit at home. He'll say, my work is my campaign. After winning the fourth election, consecutive fourth election, against this person called Pappu Yadav, I think. Yeah, Pappu Yadav. He gets assassinated 2 years after winning that. He gets assassinated and the son gets the news and he runs to the chalk. I'm describing these details because these details are what happens in the sessions. More frothy details come our way. But sometimes you're lucky to come upon these details in literature and in recounting of these emotions, because it's here that we begin to feel the emotions. So when he reaches there, he finds his son on the side of the, in the car, leaning, and as a son, hoping that he'll possibly catch something warm about this body which is dying, involuntarily his hand goes to catch the arm of the father, and his hand goes into the arm. That 107 bullets have been pumped into this man, and they have bored a hole in his arm, where this son's hand goes to catch hold of him. More than the brutality of killing, or alongside the brutality of this killing, we also need to think about these moments. This brutality must be dealing with a demon which is super mythic. 107 bullets. How many people are you killing in this one body? Who has he come to be that you have to pump 107 bullets? The son notices that parts of this father's forehead, flesh, are lying on the floor of the car. The son tells us that how in no time the entire Purnia closed down. People were so agitated, full of rage. At one point, the son runs to a central point to address this enraged mob. And he says, with folded hands, he says, I have lost my father. No other son should lose a father, because that will ruin my father's work. And he tells us that people return home, saluting internally not only a memory but a connect with the work and all the ethics that that man stood for. I'm wondering, 1,000 sons that the father remembered, and one son who has this somatic link with his own father, and that gives him the entitlement to speak on the chalk and almost reach an emulation of his own father. What is this transmission that produces this? And this is happening while the father, in one narrower portrayal, is a distant father. But his smile sobers a conclusion of this kind. This episode is about to end, and the son says that, you know, what keeps us at the work is that despite the 107 bullets, the smile on my father was there in that last darshan that he made. And there is a spontaneous applause starting from Amir Khan to the rest of the thing. This narration for me is the narration, is an illustration of what we are fond of evolving, which is the connect of one psyche in an invigorating authentic with the social. The mythic here, which is specially brought up by the recall of the smile, by the recall of the 107 bullets, by the recall of the way the hand went into the arm, these are all aspects of the myth that is getting created, and it's the myth that enhances a connection and a participation on an ordinary serial, so that the criminalization of politics and the moral support that that Bua of the previous episode is asking for is now given a fitting imagery, at least for me, I hope for some of you as well. This is the third vignette, that the imagery of the clinical as not just clinical, which is looking at the symptom, at dilemmas and conflicts in our relationships, but much more critically, of a special remote control by which things from depth are brought up, supported by the somatic link, supported by a certain trust and faith by which people's connection with people's miseries, agonies, sorrows, sadness, but with a smile. And I have no more words here to really develop it more for us. And I think perhaps the mythical has to be left like this. The mythical is a central part of where we begin to see whether our society is just a society or is beginning to get the movement towards civilizational route. This is a tougher part for me. I have not thought through this, but when I recounted and recall for you the paragraph in which Freud says the relationship of Earth to the Sun, and how something about that relationship is repeated in the organic life through instincts, then for me, these two images, symbols, signifiers, whatever terms we use, hail, on the one hand, what Kakkar and before that Kirindra Shekhar has highlighted as the maternal feminine, and what a subsequent guru of mine, Donald Winnicott, who was a child analyst, brought up as an idea of the father as distinct from the mother. I will be on a sticky wicket at the moment. I don't think I'll be able to develop these ideas, but they're important for me to conclude it for myself. I think, as I said, that a guru has to be, the idea of the guru has to be to remain in a bit of a darkness so that the theme as a guru emerges. The maternal feminine, as the words denote, suggest a Mahamaya. The ethereal but indubitable presence of the nursing, holding, containing of our needs enigmatically. that if I'm a person who is only cognitively aware of my own needs, I may take much longer to come upon the enigma. But if there is that special predisposition in me to figure out who manages to connect with my needs to produce a magical experience, then there is a good chance that I will at least discern the feminine in the maternal. Because this will require that I grow up around the relationship of others' provisions with my needs. So as I grow up, I will possibly pluck the feminine of the maternal. Both have their own. As somebody said, I think, that whenever there is a fork, you choose the fork because eventually both of these will meet to a third part. So both of these have enigmas, and they are both leading us to enigma behind. But maternal feminine is highlighting our relationship in a manner so that we are by and large plunged with a split awareness of our neediness, our attempt to rise to take charge of our neediness, and our finding that the enigma rules over the neediness. So a great deal of seduction that we would like to look slightly beyond the sexual term is something like this, where you say that knowing what I got, the relationship, what I got and what I took, that on the one hand, it should give me a clear somatic sense of what is there in my hands, in my body, as a reservoir, and what is there which is larger than this, you know, so that I'm not all the time calculating what I give and what I take. That enigma is also a step towards faith, to be able to spontaneously take while it looks to the other that I'm giving. That's the illusion. The illusion that it seems I am taking, but I am actually giving. So often people say, sir, aapne bahut achha bola. Mujhe lagta hai ki agar aapke thoughts, if your faces are not carrying that expression by which I am entering and letting this enter into me. So give and take is not easy for us to discern. So enigma in that sense is where we are allowing processes to emerge. I've written down a few things. I thought I'll read them, but I don't have a need to read them at the moment, you know. So it's this maternal feminine that we're talking about. Winnicott, as another guru, I think until death has fully visited us, people say we, Yudhishthira for instance, would marvel that how we don't carry a consciousness of death. That's the biggest surprise, that we don't carry a consciousness of death. I think each dream tells us that we are dying. In each dream we die. And yet we are surprised that we had the dream, although we don't know what is the dream doing to us, except when you become aware that the dream has interrupted something. Even if it has brought you what was the first theory of Freud, which is that of a wish fulfillment, it has nonetheless made you aware of a very small self that can only wish and then wait for the enigma to provide for it. So Winnicott suggested that it is possible that we have the image of the Father coming to us, not as a divide like this, wish and enigma, so that it's a part-object relationship. His idea was that maybe as we grow up, we begin to see an insight about the enigma and the need. So that the Father, according to Winnicott, was a whole object. So all moments of insight, illumination, flash, he would recommend that we look at it in terms of what is getting completed, what is whole, what is the insight, how this insight has a set of potential actions. Most of them will connect me with the way my past was interpreted in a distorted way, so that with the insight, the distortion is reduced. In fact, in the space of the insight, the distortion is lost, like a dream. But something better than dream, something around which the father-child relationship can be established. So when I was taking this thought up, Honey asked me this disturbing question, so she is accountable for whatever ambiguity is there in my lecture today, because 3 hours were lost in this question. She said, why do you not consider maternal the full object? So very tentative ideas. Anurag should assure me that it should not be put on the website. If it is put on the website, there should be a caveat. Caveat that Dr. Nagpal was also fumbling on this. I think the maternal feminine is, first of all, has a questionable humility. Because its function is to not only invite, not only hate, but more importantly, to remain infinite, to remain prepossessed. That it's vast. It can't be possessed. The best that we can access the maternal feminine as, I think, I might be completely wrong, but I want to dare it here. The best that the maternal feminine can be brought up here is when two extremes, like a koan, you know, when I say, I am the death and I am the birth. When I say, I am the past and I am the future. And when I say this with a conviction that heralds no doubt, no doubt whatsoever, huh? This is what Gita does. It's giving you this swing. It is actually asking a necessary lulling of the mind. A necessary lulling of the mind so that the other processes can blossom. For me, the maternal feminine has this special quality of evolving a pluck of itself. I have to pluck something. In that sense, it's more than the whole. It is infinite. Whereas the semblance of a whole is what is created by the father. For me, this relationship between the father as a whole object in relation with the enigma of need and enigma called maternal feminine is where the guru eventuates, never to end. But to create good illusions when I create milestones of insight and for a while can pursue them with less splits and less dissociations, but they are a must to our life. I'll stop here with sharing that at times my friend Vijay Verma, he's here today, and I'm especially thankful to many senior faculty from AUD, because this has been a deep wish that sometimes they should come and listen to our rambling. So he has come and he's often said that, Ashok, I don't understand what you talk. And he takes a special delight in announcing to me that he doesn't understand at all. So I hope his wife seduced him to come here. I hope that he also has a good question to sort of move this conversation between us a little forward. But things that happen in session sometimes are electrifying. And a very bad habit that we as analysts, therapists have cultivated here is that we don't write our sessions. There are exceptions to it, but mostly we don't write our sessions. And I think today I learned that we don't write our sessions because there's a huge melancholy in the mindset of this. You know, that the father object has not emerged as clearly as, say, Sudhir would have liked us to own him. And Kristeva suggests that when writing is very close to melancholy, its first task is to create melancholy, to reproduce melancholy. So not writing is our way of remaining in the melancholic state. This is no defense, no exemption. But I think the hope is counted here that the next generation will of necessity do it. So at one point, Anurag and Anup told me, "Hum aap se young hai, we'll go ahead of you. Aap kyun itna envious ho?" I think sometimes the patients bring processes to us in the sessions which I wish one could share. One could share in the way they bring you up. In the way they make you forget things which are like, who is a husband and a wife? That in the din of the thick listening, which is coming out of their own splits and melancholy, sometimes the mind of the listener, like a child, forgets and learns later what was the significance of that forgetting. You know, how is it that he's talking about a husband and a wife? Who are they? And the fact that you come to hold this doubt indicates that a powerful speech was made perhaps by the wife to this person, in which she indicated that because of a whole series of traumas that have happened in so quick a space that they become like a whole series unending, you know, that as a result of which the woman, an older woman, comes to a figure who is boy-like, son-like to him, and says, "When will you become responsible? When will you all kids become responsible? Do you know what I have been going through? From task, mundane task A to mundane task B, to upholding my body, which produces eddies." It stuns them. Back to themselves, it produces eddies, imagination as to what's happening with our mother-like figure or mother. And one day, this son can, imagine a painting, I mean, this son can suddenly, if he shows somebody somehow in a painting, getting up and Oedipus-like just shooting off a message to an older woman. "Can I sleep with you?" I think the beginning of the relational guru starts here. Freud has always wanted the Oedipus to emerge in all of us, to see this wish which has its own nobility, and this wish which has its own tragic value, not just of the person concerned, but at least insofar as Indian society is concerned, a whole lot of family in it, both which is genetic family and the other one that we took up in the thousand sons. That we are all the time looking for families here, sometimes to evade this special link, this special fondness, this special bond by which, and binding in psychoanalysis is much like the way I learned that liver produces, which is it produces a chemical to detox something by making it water soluble so that it can be evacuated. So sometimes patients help us renew this as an everyday part of our work, to understand that the crisis outside the clinic is not as divorced. To take charge of an institution is slightly more or less, whichever way you see, than to take charge of a mother-like figure who has also said, "Who is going to listen to me? Who is going to take care of me? Whether in removing furniture from here to there, or my body which has become a furniture." Thank you.
Can we take questions? I must thank Professor Nagpal. How do I begin?
Just kiss my water.
Yeah. I think I'll open it to a few reflections and questions, and not try to give a kind of formal, response or a kind of formal framing, I should say, to the talk or the discussion he has initiated, because I'm having my doubts that would be the function of the whole. That would be kind of a father function. And what it would be to keep the infinite open, keep the feminine in the maternal open. So I don't want to formally frame it and don't want to make it a responsible function of the whole, but want to keep the infinite open, or maybe keep the beyond alive, as you perhaps have tried to initiate among us, or endanger us, actually, with a beyond. So I think I'll let questions be posed, and then we can come back to see what happened. Yes, please. How will you ask the question? Without a mic, can you?
No, can you hear me?
Yeah, we can.
Hello. Yeah? How you memorialized Freud today was really spectacular for me personally, because as someone who studies literature, Freud's use of analogy is absolutely primary. And what you did was you, I'm sure you know this maybe, you connected really from beginning to end with stories and analogies, ordinary life, social life, political situations. And I was wondering what was going to happen at the end there. And in fact, you ended with Oedipus. And that was very exciting for me. Although I am curious, you know, I'm more curious about the Indian mythology and the connections there. But I think that he would be very pleased by what happened here. So, thank you.
Thank you. Do you want to respond? It's thanking Indian Oedipus Park. Yeah. Are there all questions out there?
Urvashi.
I was just curious. You brought up just once about a lull in the mind, and I became curious about what would Freud have to say about the importance of bringing a lull in the mind and what happens in that moment.
The good things that happen around the lull in the mind are reveries, huh? So that as a listener, the intellectual function is lowered. The not so good things about lull is that you go off to sleep. And then if you are lucky, you can have a dream. But most likely, you'll have to admit that you are failing something. And that can be a very surprising change. Can be a surprising change. But it's an intersection of all kinds of things that can happen, you know, about lull in the mind. I'm speaking about lull in the mind in the session. Lull in the mind in this audience is that I'm certainly boring. I mean, so I think I'll have to admit to a certain unconscious hostility in me, a limit that I cannot recognize, so that I want to break free of something, and that can be reproduced in the other as a lull of the mind, you know. So when somebody is very boring, the coping is to have a lull in the mind.
I thought the relation was with, you talked about the Bhagavad Gita, I think, and the lull in the mind. So I don't think the Gita really wants you to get bored when you're reading it, right?
Achha, okay, in that sense, huh?
Ah, in that sense.
I think I took it up in a bit to illustrate a surface of the maternal feminine, but in a voice which doesn't let you see it as maternal feminine. Huh? But it is like an ultimate provision when Krishna speaks those words to Arjuna, that this is me. Huh? My roop of this and my roop of this, both of these are me. Huh? And you can't think about which one. Huh? So that lull of the mind is then opening up the other to another state of utter faith. What does this utter faith does to Arjuna in terms of the questions would be an interesting pursuit to develop this question with you about lull of the mind. Huh? Am I making sense? That Gita is certainly asking you to swing between two extremes and develop faith. But this faith will require questions. Those questions have to be arrived at. Huh? You want to say something?
You have to say more from this.
From this?
Yeah.
Go on saying more?
Yeah.
I did try to excuse myself by saying that... kya hua?
Yeah, sir.
I have fully grasped the idea of enigma here, but... how would this arrival to a question, how much of it would be, let's say, be dependent on experiencing something enigmatic or just coming to the sense of enigma?
I would tend to think that enigma is where the experience cannot be developed. But you have this sense that there is something tantalizing, engaging, doesn't let you think of categories. So I would tend to think that experience and enigma have the potential of creating a transition. But nothing more than that. Maybe it'll depend on the... For instance, if I were to go quiet here, to both the lull in the mind and this question, and Anup were to say, you have to speak more, and I say, I can't. Maybe I don't want to. And then I say, didn't I say that I'm also grappling with the same issue here? So I've gone looking at the obtuseness of the enigma, and I'm looking at surfaces there, and I have a sense that you're drawing me somewhere without offering me why you're being drawn to this question. Would that enhance enigma, or would that stump something in us? So I'm suggesting that enigma is perhaps better lived out as playing. So if I had a lovely expression here of a smile and say, these are very interesting questions, then I would have perhaps enhanced the enigma. And when Girindshekhar Bose wrote to him about, to Freud about the way Indian patients look at the feminine themselves, the wish to be a woman, Freud said very enigmatically that he'll keep this in his mind. So, depending on the trust that you have in the ability that somebody who says these words will pursue them, will keep them, is where enigma has a chance of unfolding something. So if you bring in a certain experience that has fallen short of, how to retain itself while the enigmatic is starring, is where I think the process can be developed. Then one can say, I can keep this part in mind. Or to take one more example, that when I said that this woman said that please give us moral support. That was an enigmatic moment for me. I knew she's right, she wants it, but I didn't know what. What can be a moral support? It's only a little later that I can come to one meaning, one possible way of emoting about that moral support need in that verse. I won't ask you, am I making myself intelligible, huh?
Hi, I just wanted to say two questions really stood out. One was when you were being introduced, when you said that, you know, is it psychoanalysis in India or Indian psychoanalysis? And the other thing which you had brought up was that how would Freud feel about himself being perceived as a guru in any way? And I think that kind of triggered my question, which was, and pardon me if I don't word this quite well, but how would Freud, if you had to answer like Freud, how would Freud place culture and gurus in the psychoanalytic framework? Would he think that us trying to understand them better is moving closer to the center or extending those margins, as you had put it? I don't know if that made sense.
If the definition of guru is of someone who dispels darkness, then Freud would have perhaps liked also to say spell darkness, you know. Try to spell darkness. So that perhaps he would accept, because he lived by this. That.
Can I add a point here,
sir? Yeah, please.
No, I just want the you know, the one twist he was offering today, I think, with respect to the idea of the guru, was that the guru is not necessarily that invokes light. Though our usual, you know, naturalized notion of the guru is something who brings in enlightenment or some light, some hope. But the guru is also a repository, as you were trying to push today, of a relationship with darkness. And Kakkar actually, in one of his books, suggests that the guru is also an angle of radical regression. He says that, and that is a way of reframing the guru also, I thought, which he was trying to do today, that the guru is not necessarily what we think of as the guru, but the guru as a as that which integuments us with darkness. You know, it's a skin, it's a surface also. Yeah, please. Take the mic.
I think the role of guru is so embedded in culture and the way we understand it, whether you look at it as a father figure or you look at it as a mythical figure or you look at it as God or whatever you want to see it. It's so embedded in culture that somewhere it's not just looking up to someone. I think it's also about what we designate to somebody in that position and how we perceive them. And so I was wanting to understand that in terms of culture, where would Freud place are wanting to understand culture now, which we realize is such an important part of, you know, psychoanalytic process and how we one would practice and all of that. How would he fit in understanding culture and the role of a guru in that case?
We'll make another effort. Huh? Since the culture of the Freudian times has changed, even in Delhi, we can say. So there's another interesting thought that you might like to think more about, which is that how about couple as a prelude to guru? One of the links that Kernberg and Kakkar both make in independent ways is to suggest that for me to think of darkness within my being, one direction of one dimension of that would be the woman in me. So the relationship that I live out in a heterosexual couple to begin with, would then be a way of evolving that relationship outside of me. And since there is an enigma there, we are suggesting that the quantum leaps can only be made when I can come upon such conduct, with such finesse, I can come upon an analysis of conduct which tells me not only, enhances not only my relational experience in the couplehood, but also gives me a stable sense of future with which to revisit my past and not to forget to eject myself out of this to a dream of solitude. So couple to guru is where you can see that the analytic dyad begins as a couple. You know, so we've taken some time to see that the foundation of reaching cultures which have gurus is precisely to begin with the dyad. So gurus are often compared to mothers and, you know, mother-child relationship and so on. So it's not that far that it might have looked in Freud's times. Luckily, we are not there. You know?
I have a question. Sorry. I have a question that what is the role of confusion in the psychoanalytical framework in order to form a relation? Because I think the confusion play an important role to form identity. That is different from the what a group can give.
Psychoanalytically, the small step around the confusion will be that it is not just in you, you know. It is also transmitting itself to me. And so it can come as confusion. That will be difficult for then both of us to address the question. But just to say that it's not just in you can sort out the confusion. So early sessions, let's say, are often aimed at showing that large part of the symptoms are not to be seen as you, but as aspects of you that have not been given voice, that have not been received, that have not gone into kind of a dialogic relationship. So confusion is not just in you. The more difficult situation is where the confusion of the other comes into me. You know, and then a certain rigidification can happen even in the listener. So on the one hand, we can begin with it. On the other hand, we await the more difficult levels. Perhaps you shouldn't tax people with more questions. You know, sir?
Pressure to ask questions.
Yes.
Okay.
Vijay, if Vijay would like to make a comment, I would be personally eager.
Yes.
I don't know what I have to respond will make any sense to you or not. Just as you don't make sense to me, I don't think I make sense to you.
That's not true.
But I will not rise to your bait, even though I will make one comment, and that is, listening to you, I recently read a quote, and I think in order to, instead of my commenting on what your talk was, let me just repeat the quotation. I don't quite know. I think it is Lewis, but I'm not sure who the author is. And basically what he says is that from the deficits, we may know the talents. From the exceptions, we may discern the rules. And from the pathologies, we may come up with a model of health. And I think this is probably summarizes what you're trying to do. And I wish you success in your quest, whether I understand you or not. Thank you.
No questions. Nothing. Honey? No? Let me pose one to you, sir.
Vinita is asking.
Vinita?
Then you do that.
Can I talk like this? Well, I thought that Freud, in those historical times, was struggling hard against the relationality. When he was talking about carrying that neutral, abstinent self into the clinic as an analyst, he was also not talking as much as we do today about counter-transference and how more relational and dynamic internal relationships come into play in the clinic. And I thought that these were the, probably, for want of a better word, these were the repressed aspects of his theory when we talk about the role of surprise, the role of relationality. He talked more about the internal objects, the internal dynamic, more than the outside. And I think we've been able to avail more of that potential that he pointed towards, was struggling against. And I think today's talk was I'm kind of feeling a little fidgety. He happens to be my brother, and I feel a little embarrassed saying that. Well, I found it to be brilliant. And I think it addressed those repressed aspects of Freud's work that have come into play post-Freud.
Thank you for pointing out the darker part of it.
Anymore? Anil. Shifa.
Shifa. Yeah. Tough question.
So I'm going to struggle a little bit and see if I can articulate it. I was thinking about that moment when Ajit wanted to grab his father's arm, and his hand went into his squishy flesh. And I think one of the things that is remarkable about psychoanalysis is how it opens up this, dynamic field of self and other, and who is the other, and whether this other is within me or always outside. And I was thinking about whether this moment in which Ajit's hands goes into his father's mutilated body also takes us back to another myth in which Eklavya is asked by Dron, that I have been your guru. Now give me the guru dakshina. And in that also we see, that what does the other mean to us, even when the other is not conscious to their being so significant to us. And so I just because we were talking about some states that arise in lull. So I was thinking about Ajit being that Eklavya to his own father, that he grasps something of him without his own self-awareness, and whether in that paradox actually we meet the other in a way that we wouldn't have in the flesh and in body.
Shifa, your comment I've just received, and I'm also taking time to, because for me, that expression of the hand going into the hole of the arm was like things that happen in the sessions when the very feeling of the mucus, blood, and other things that produce unmentable kinds of sensations and thoughts. And I think this may even be connected to Vinita's thing that the early Freud had to go into that, also being a doctor, that he had so much of this body to attend to see the relationship with what got translated as instincts and other things, rather than the way they were closer in German language, to other connotations.
Sir, I have a question. Good evening, first of all.
Good evening.
I have a question which I don't know whether it's going to make sense right now or not. If you look at most of the guru figures that have been talked about in mythology, you have Guru Brahma, Guru Vishnu, it's male figures. After that, during the course of your lecture, you spoke about how the father figure is usually a distant figure whenever Freud is spoken about. And then also the part that a teacher usually feels like a parent regarding his students, his or her students. There's a sense of ownership over the students. So I have these three disconnected thoughts about why does the guru, if a guru shiksha relationship has to be a dyad, it can be a parent and a child, it can be a guru, and but why does it have to be a male figure? And if you can sort of give me a closure about the three distinct parts that are there, but I'm not able to connect them, and I would appreciate if you could find a connection between the three.
I hope, I'll try. I think the the articulation of anything as it produces symbols, forms, structures, is where the male imagination is suggested. Wherever there is flow and a sense of a process without any inhibition or blockage, we would suggest a feminine, maternal feminine kind of thing. So just because something is articulately emphasized should not be taken to mean that its derivation from the process is being undermined. In fact, that's what I tried to say, that that's where I am trying to understand maternal feminine with the father as a full object. So in our culture, the potence to the feminine form, the culture of Devi, is an attempt to retain that link slightly away from this male principle. But still, that's where I think Freud remains the master of, and he's often cited in terms of the kind of beginnings that happened in his writings, even though he did not conceptualize them. So later thinkers like Winnicott and Beyond, Winnicott less, but Beyond, Klein, etc., they're often shown as deriving their thought from there, which is to say that Freud was the first one to formulate those directions without creating concepts out of them. But so much has happened after that, you know. So Freud then becomes more like a god, and people in other disciplines would say, you know, what is this relationship with Freud? It's because the dimension he has evolved, and now there are, of course, dimensions where Freud seems to have been completely wrong in his conception. So he's a god with his own clay feet also.
Usama.
Actually, sir, even I am very confused. I had decided not to ask this question or put forward this request because I wasn't very sure. But since we are talking of relationships, and when Shifa asked her question with some difficulty, even she wasn't sure, and you decided to hold on to it and not to answer it immediately, that did something, relational guru, something like that, and gave me that, passed on that courage, okay, I can also put forward my bits and pieces. So the, like, out of all that you said when you were there, only one thing is that I would say stuck in my head, and that is this line that you said, and the smile goes to the sun. And then you were just narrating that episode from Amir Khan's show, and I was expecting, I was wanting you to say something more about it. Like you said, the smile goes to the sun, and then you continued with the story that was there in Amir Khan's show, and then again the smile, you mention it again, but by then that smile was on a dead face, on a dead body. But still that goes to the sun, and the sun rushes to the chalk, and he in a way takes up the role of his father and addresses the crowd the way his father did. and also like Shifa pointed out, before that he enters the body through a bullet wound. So I don't know, I think it's a request only. So today, like Honey Ma'am said, birthdays are not just a beginning, but also histories. So today when Freud's birthday, history. So like, what is it that has been passed on to you? Like, are you that eager son who rushes to the chalk and addresses them all? And our friend here says that whatever she had known of Freud was very primary, like coming from literature, but you put forward something else that wasn't known about Freud. Like the son reminds the mob of the father's ethics and all. So like, what is that smile or something that makes you the that son of Freud out of all the few remaining sons here? Who has the courage to address the mob?
I'm grateful to
good question.
I was also quite doubtful about whether I should ask this question, but now that this young man here did ask the question, from that moment onwards, I mean, that's one of the few episodes of Satyameva Jayate that I have actually seen. And I saw it from the point where this Bua says, give us moral support. And I didn't know what she was asking moral support for. So that did not make an impact at all on me. However, when I saw this Ajit Sarkar episode, now to me, that entire episode, when it ended, there was this one shot which was focusing on Amir Khan. And I saw a tinge of envy in Amir Khan's face.
Envy.
And I thought that, oh my God, this man is traumatized. And he's traumatized by the fact that here is this man sitting in front of him who has a father he can look up to. You know, he can tell this story about a father, and it's an awe-inspiring story. So there was a tinge of envy out there. And I don't know why I registered the tinge of envy, because I was thinking more like, what happens when you don't have a guru? What happens when you don't have a father? Or what happens when you don't want to have the father that you have? When you're actually rejecting your biological father and don't accept him to be the father in various kinds of senses of the term.
Yeah.
And then that's when you're seeking for fathers outside your relationship with your father. And that is what I felt was that episode about for Amir Khan. Because here was this man whose smile can be passed on to his son. And despite the father saying something like, I have 1,000 sons, that didn't make an iota of an impact on that young man. It must have at that point when... You believe me, I did. When I saw that episode, I thought, oh my God, poor young man. I mean, here is this father saying that, you know, okay, forget it, I have 1,000 sons. But that really, he transcended that moment, you see. He outgrew that moment where he was thinking that I have 1,000, my father has 1,000 sons, I don't matter. Because he understands that when his hand goes through that injured arm, he's the one who rises to the occasion and says that, you know, I have lost a father. Although all of Purnia believes they have lost a father. So he has also gained a father at that moment.
Absolutely, that's right.
So that was what I was thinking all this while, you know. And I didn't and I was asking Anil that I didn't know how the connection was made between the moral support and this one. But now I kind of understood it.
Yeah.
So. However, I mean, I don't understand how the maternal feminine comes in, but I suppose I'll just keep that aside.
Yeah.
Because I think that'll take a longer time for me to understand.
Anil should be close to you.
Thank you anyway.
Yeah, thanks.
I think we should end because I'm getting a note that we must end. But it is only towards the end we are coming alive. I had just a couple of thoughts, and you may choose, as you are doing now, not to respond. I thought you created a kind of preamble for us today. A kind of preamble, at least some of us have been in search of, and I put it in that manner at the beginning, Indian psychoanalysis or psychoanalysis in India. And I thought you showed us, in a way, that while we all along thought psychoanalysis was a response to the father's death, beyond the pleasure principle, interestingly, is a response to the daughter's death.
Mm-hmm.
And Savitri and Satyavan is a response to the partner's death. And psychoanalysis is always a way of bringing alive the dead, conjuring the dead, as Hamlet would be, conjuring the dead father in terms of a moral taboo principle. But you have created for us, I think, the preamble for Indian psychoanalysis today. Anurag, let me risk it. In the way that you have conjured for us two different deaths, the death of the daughter and the death of the partner. One Freud managed to encounter in his life, one you have managed to encounter in your life, where I think you provocatively invoked for us the Savitri Satyavan, and it's not one actually. There are so many actually in the mythopoetic we all inhabit in some way or the other. And Islam doesn't have the death of the father. There's no parricide in Islam. Much of it doesn't have the death of the father. So it also shows how the whole of psychoanalysis needs to find a hole in it all the time, puncture itself and refind itself. And I think that's the preamble or the groundwork of Indian psychoanalysis. And you set up a relationship with death today. So while we have always wondered a relationship between Eros and Thanatos, between life and death as principles, what you have done for us today, I think, and I have been a student again today, I must admit. You make me a student again and again. That you have offered us a few other deaths. And other deaths, and when they are conjured, they give us an other psychoanalysis. And that could be a preamble for what I think. The practice of psychoanalysis in India, giving birth to Indian psychoanalysis. And that is a contribution, I must say, today. And you mustn't hesitate to put this up on YouTube. The one question I had, which I cannot resolve for myself, just as Usha cannot resolve it for herself, is Savitri the maternal feminine, or is Savitri the maternal feminine? And you...
Come again?
Maternal? Is Savitri the maternal of the feminine, or is Savitri the feminine of the maternal? And you left us over there, I thought, that between relationship with death and between relationship with Eros, you found yourself a little uncertain over there. And how would you mark it? I thought it's an interesting figure, or a figurative, or a trope, perhaps, wondering at Savitri's relationship for ourselves. Is she... I don't know where I'll italicize. In the maternal feminine, will I italicize maternal, or will I italicize the feminine? And it's an interesting conundrum you have left us with, I think, to imagine sexed subject positions in the Indian context, where we are. In that sense, I think these two, according to me, as far as I could gather or collate, I'm still struggling to fully. The fully never comes, actually, because the whole will never come. But these, I thought, were two fundamental contributions, at least as they are coming to me. And would you like to respond? Go ahead.
And I think there's some thoughts which need to be savored in terms of a breakthrough that you have. And for me, whenever a kind of a polarization happens like this, or as you are somewhat playfully, you know, your mind goes into these emphases. Perhaps I, in a very unthinking way, brought the two or accepted the two as together. Huh? For me, the maternal is a surface that we meet as a child, and feminine is a surface that we meet as a slightly more later stage of our relationship, you know. And you're saying that there's a continuity between these two, which is unspecified. So perhaps there is some point in looking at the emphasis that comes. Certainly, there is space for both, because she was wished for as a girl, and she's born as a boy. So she needs a maternity in that sense. She needs a maternal thing. To the extent that she makes death experience feelings, you know. So when we say infinite should remain open, I think the only lacuna is that infinite as death and our feelings over there are kept out, you know. So feel a moment of dying is to enable a kind of a choice of a very temporary dialectic kind to choose this, but both, none of these is important, more important than the other, you know. So to come closer to feeling one is the way we respond to Savitri's need for the maternity, to come close to the capacity that she has found, where has she stolen it from, you know, to become feminine to Yamraj is where.
Yes.
You know, well, so these are the kinds of.
Comes. Let him have the last word. Let us join. Two applause. Wonderful.
Thank you. Could I request Shalini to hand the flowers to Dr. Nagpal and Anup?
Flowers?
As the most mystical of all of us.
And some thorns. Chalo, try to kar.
Thank you. And
history today, something historical to you.
Is something here?
Yeah. Okay. This is it.
Okay, thank you.
Very much.
Thank you very much, all of you. Thank you very much for this occasion. It's also a kind of an invitation to bring in psychoanalysis in a more public space and sort of provoke each other's minds. Thank you very much.
Thank you all for coming. I would like the people from AUD especially to meet me, stay here and meet me after the talk has ended. I needed to do something.